You're watching All To Play For, brought to you by Joe and Coral.
Welcome to All To Play For, brought to you by Joe and Coral, with myself, Adam Smith, and the legend that is Joe Cole. Joe, should we get straight into it and introduce our guests?
Let's get straight into it. Legend that is.
The legend that is. I think that is a good word, because joining us today, one of the funniest blokes in the country, is the star and creator of the smash hit BBC sitcom Not Going Out, king of stand-ups, the prince of the panel show, the undisputed superstar, I'm calling him Soccer Aid as well, and your mate, Lee Mack. Lee, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thanks for having me. I'm very pleased to be here.
I've got to ask you about your first memories of meeting and playing with Lee.
Well, first of all,
can I just say how surreal that is?
Yeah,
he used to play for England, and you're asking him the first time he met me what it was like. That's why I do Soccer Aid, just for these strange moments.
So that's bang on. Soccer Aid, just so strange, because I'm a big fan of Not Going Out. So meeting Lee, and then watching Would I Lie to You and everything, and meeting him and being in that environment where you've got the footballers, and you've got the comedians and singers. Like, you'd be sitting there. What Soccer Aid? You'd be sitting there. And you'd be chatting to someone, they'd be bantering, and then some fella would be singing over there, and then some gymnast would be spinning in his head. It's like, it's the surrealest thing ever.
Yeah. It's also,
and the players love it.
When you realise that everyone wants to do a different job. I was sat next to Sean Wright Phillips, who was watching Dermot Kennedy singing in the bar, and he was transfixed like that. And I said, "You're right." And he went, "I wish I could do that." And I said, "Would you have given up football to be able to do that?" And he went, 100%. All the pop stars want to be footballers, all the footballers want to be comedians, all the comedians want to be pop stars.
Yeah.
Never going around cycle.
Amazing. We're going to talk in depth about Soccer Aid. Loved watching that recently. Brilliant event, and we'll talk about just how good it was, the money raised and everything. Before we get into that, you seem to be everywhere, Lee. Just tell us what's going on with you at the minute.
I'm just shamelessly trying to get any money I can by doing, literally anything.
Anything?
Anything.
Yeah, okay.
No, I'm doing my sitcom, Not Going Out, which starts next week. But I have to say, over the last 2 to 3 weeks, I've been mainly trying to focus on my international footballing career.
Okay, how's that going?
Since Soccer Aid, I thought, well, you might as well grab the opportunity. So I've been touting myself around the bigger clubs.
My agent's actually coming here, so we can put together a little CV for you.
That'd be great. Yeah,
Usain Bolt did.
I know.
Off the back of Soccer Aid, some Australian team was going to take him as a professional.
Yeah, to be fair, I think he originally wanted to play for Manchester United, and then he realised he was a bit more realistic and went to Australia, didn't he?
Start off there, build your way up.
Yeah. It's a bit like TV. If you try and get a TV career and it's not panning out, you do that in Australia. Do you know what I mean? It's like when you watch a film, isn't it? You watch a film and it looks brilliant, and the first accent you hear is Australian, you go, oh. No, he's got that feeling, hasn't he? Do you know what I mean? Well, you know, that's fine. You're trying your best.
I've got a feeling, Joe, this episode is going to be just brilliant. It's going to go off on all sorts of tangents, isn't it?
We love a tangent.
Yeah, we do love a tangent. That's very true. I've always wanted to know, what part of your job do you enjoy? You obviously do panellist, acting, stand-up. What part gives you the most satisfaction? International football,
correct. The lazy part of me loves the panel game, would I lie to you, because you just literally turn up. I mean, we just turn up and play a game. Yeah. So that's the lazy part of me. And it's a good laugh. Me and David and Rob are good mates, so that's brilliant. But the sort of thing that gives me the most creative satisfaction is my sitcom, probably, because I spend 6 months editing it and writing it and casting it, all sorts of things involved in it. So it's quite an involved process. In fact, my wife in it, Sally Breton, is the sister of your producer, Jack.
Yes, I heard that.
Yeah, small world, isn't it? The one that
used to
look
like
Jude Law, which will mean nothing.
So this is a good-looking family all round
here, isn't it? Jack's in me here going, keep this conversation going.
So that's probably, that's the thing that's kept me going. That's the thing I do most of for the last 10, 15 years.
Do you know what's like? It's interesting because your whole creative process, like when you're involved in that, so Would I Lie to You? It's such family friendly. I watched it for the first time. It's one of the things when it's on, you watch it, and I watched it with my daughter for the first time 2 weeks ago. She's 11. She loved it. Like trying to guess whether they're, like Lee's stuff is quite, it's family friendly. And they don't make sitcoms like that.
No, that's true.
So if anyone's listening and they haven't watched Not Going Out, go back and watch it. It's brilliant.
But the earliest, there is the odd bit of language in the earlier stuff. So don't watch the first.
She's a Coley. She's heard all of the words.
She's heard all the words.
Yeah.
She reads your reviews, does she?
Yeah.
Let's talk about your relationship with football. You're a Blackburn fan.
Yes, I am.
How sort of big Blackburn? How big was Blackburn growing up?
Well, I used to go back in the Simon Garner days, back in the 80s. Right. You know, when Blackburn was sort of. See, what happened was I was a Liverpool fan when I was a kid.
Oh, were you?
And then we moved to Blackburn, and my mum and dad were in the pub trade. And at the time, I was reading Roy the Rovers, and there was lots of stories in Roy the Rovers about sort of non-league sides and Liverpool were winning everything in the 70s, you know, and early 80s. So I thought, wouldn't it be good to support a rubbish side? Because it's more glamorous supporting a rubbish side.
I know what you mean.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so I transferred to Blackburn when I was about 10 or 11. And then since then, Blackburn have won the Premier League and Liverpool hadn't until a couple of years.
Must have been so smug then when they did win the Premier League.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Because totally. You've gone for the underdog and it's worked out.
And it's worked out, yeah. And it was all through hard work, nothing to do with Jack Walker's money. Yeah. Just hard work.
Fond memories still to this day, I imagine, for a lot of Blackburn fans that year.
That is brilliant. And I've actually since become good mates with Graham Lasseau, and obviously he was part of that 95 winning side, you know. So I get all the gossip as well, which is great, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I remember that side. That was a great side. Mm.
Unbelievable.
Did you play against them? You would have done. No, that would have been your era, wouldn't
I played
it?
Against, I, no,
you're a bit young then, weren't you?
99, I made my debut. So the back end of the top Blackburn side.
You were basically waiting for Blackburn. You were waiting for Blackburn to disappear a bit before you were willing to take part.
Not stepping into that fray. But David Dunn, Damien Duff. You still had a good team when we played.
David Bentley.
Yeah.
One of my favourite players. He wasn't part of the 95, but I like David Bentley because I'm obsessed by the fact that at the peak of his career, well, certainly the peak of his age, 27, he just packed it in. He went, I don't want to do this anymore. I'm going to do property development in Tenerife.
And he's got a flooring business as well. Apparently. Yeah. Like,
well, it's every kid's 3 minutes to one day have your own flooring business. You know what I mean? Yeah, some of us don't ever get to live that dream. If they ever do Soccer Aid for flooring, I'm in.
He's certainly an anomaly. I remember him being in one England squad. Benton, like it was under the Capello era, and you know he had a strict, you know, like no butter. There was no
Capello.
Capello. He was really strict.
Did you say no toast then?
No tomato ketchup.
No,
wasn't one?
No butter on your toast. No tomato ketchup. It was very bland. We couldn't eat. Like you're telling grown men you can't eat at certain times. Yeah. You're trying to tell like Steven Gerrard in the peak of his career, he can't have a bowl of cornflakes.
This is why I love doing Soccer Aid, right? Because when people whinge in soccer, when I hear the professionals whinging, it's never what you think it's going to be. It's never going to be, oh, and he crunched me with a tackle and brought me. It's always about the no butter on the toast. You know what I mean?
It's a common thing.
I mean, he wouldn't even allow us maple syrup in our porridge. The man was an animal.
But he was such a... And Bent's like you said, he's a bit of an enigma. I turned up and he was just sitting having a beer. And his window, clear as day, for everyone walking past, really? Could have been Capello. Like, he just really, he didn't give monkeys about anything.
Wow.
And, like, hence the reason he retired at 29.
Yeah, yeah. The glory days of drinking beer in your windowsill when England didn't used to win anything.
Yeah.
The glory days, indeed.
And they drink protein shakes now, and we still don't bloody win anything.
Yeah. So. We're getting close, though.
You know me, I'm a big believer in this squad.
Yeah.
I think the whole process has changed the way that we develop young players, and I think now they're better equipped than we were to win something.
And I think, fingers crossed, we're going in the right direction. I know what you like at football because we've seen it with soccer. Were you always a keen footballer as a young kid? School teams, what sort of level?
You probably didn't notice what happened though. So I know what you like as a footballer because I've seen you. Were you always keen? You know what I mean? Didn't say, were you always that good? Or did you always have that natural flair? Were you always keen? I mean,
this is going to be the problem with that. I've got to really think about every question.
That's all, you know what I mean?
I've got to really think about the phrasing of every question today, Joe.
I've loved football. I used to have a game with comedians. We used to have lots of long journeys when we were doing the circuit and stuff, and lots of long journeys up north. And I'd always play the game of if I knew they were a football fan, how low would you go to have swapped your comedy career for a football career?
Yeah.
So it wouldn't have to be Man United or something. I was always Doncaster Rovers.
Okay.
I would have played for Doncaster Rovers and not been a comedian.
Really?
But since doing Soccer Aid and getting to meet the footballers and learning, as in every job, there's some negatives to it as well. There's not just all, you know, it's pros and cons. Yeah. I've had to go higher now. So now said I'm only willing to sort of join a Barcelona or a Real Madrid. Because I realise it's just there's a lot of, you know, there's no butter on the toast.
Yeah,
there's all sorts of toast. You know what I mean?
That's a big thing for you, that, Joe.
He
certainly puts coal mining into perspective, doesn't it? When you're not getting butter on your toast.
You do have to catch yourself. Like sometimes when I'm talking about the Capello eras and we're moaning about butter on the toast, I can put myself in the punters.
As you were saying that,
You know what I mean?
But it's always
but it was just a little annoying thing.
Butter on the toast. Right, we've got to move on.
We don't got Capello coming on the show anytime soon, have we?
Quiet. He looks straight at Jack there, just for clarity.
I always thought Capello looked like a Bo Selecta. You know Bo Selecta?
He
looked like he was just trying to audition for Bo Selecta. He had the underbite and the big glasses.
Do you know, I was in that. He had no banter, right? And I was in the office once with the girls. And we're sitting there, he come in, and for some reason he started up a conversation. His English was broken. And one of the girls said to him, "You've got no grey hair." And he got very defensive about, he said, no.
Oh, I see.
He was like, no, I don't dye it. I don't dye my hair. And then I thought, I'd never noticed. I thought, and I'm looking over, He's got the thickest black... He was in his 60s, thick black hair. And he was very upset that the girls were accusing him of dyeing his hair.
Really? Should we talk Soccer Aid? First of all, I've got to say, the most important thing with Soccer Aid is that the money raised... Obviously, you both played. There's so many questions I've got about the experience, but it's an unbelievable cause, isn't it? Was it over 13 million raised?
I think this was the record year this year. Over 30 million quid, which is, if you consider the last year and a half, 2 years, and everyone's struggled with COVID and stuff, so... It's brilliant, absolutely brilliant. And then the total amount of 10 or... Well, it's been 15 years, you know, that they've done Soccer Aid. I think it's whatever. It's 60 million, maybe, something like that.
It's an incredible thing, Lee. And like, for me, it's an eye-opener because I don't know nothing about, like, not like Chunks and, like, the influencers, the YouTube generation. So, you know, obviously I know Lee, I know Paddy and all the guys have been on telly, but the people put their money in their pockets, turn up to watch your Chunkses and that, play football and they love them, don't they?
Oh, I'll tell you,
it's unbelievable.
When I go to Soccer Aid, I think that people are going to say to me, do me a favour, can you get me a photograph of Joe Cole or whatever?
Yeah.
It's always...
Not interested in football.
It's always the people I've never heard of.
Really?
Because it's always the people on YouTube and stuff. It's always the... Yeah. That's who the babysitter wants.
Yeah.
The babysitter didn't even mention you.
I'm not surprised.
She's 18.
Wasn't bothered about a photo with Joe,
No. She, anyone over the age of 25, she's not interested.
Wow. But
Chunks and Philly. Yeah. That was like, that was a big deal,
Like it's an eclectic bunch. I think that's why it works. And you've got to get, I think the footballers, because what happens when we play, Lee, like, it's all laughing and joking, we're having a great time. I love the build-up. And then you get into the game and then the competitive juices kick in.
Yeah.
But you have to constantly remember to yourself, it's a TV show.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? You need to make
for it entertaining. Yeah. But it's incredible that you watch the professionals do that. They do click into that sort of like... Gets quite...
It does, yeah.
Does it? Competitive.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, I've done it for 4 years and I have to say that the competitiveness mainly comes, I think, from the celebs.
More so than the pros?
Well, it depends what you mean by competitive. When it comes to like crunching tackles, obviously the pros are better at that. Yeah. So they do more of that. But certainly the wanting to win.
Really? Wow.
I think that it's the celebrities that perhaps had a chance when they were younger to make it.
Right.
They're keen to show that they've still got it. Whereas I didn't even make the school team. So my bar's so low.
So who are you talking about then? Go on, can you reveal names or is that
well, to be honest with you, it's most of them because most of them, I found the first time I did it, I was like, I play five-a-side with the dads and I'm just very average, didn't make the school team. That's all. I thought everyone was going to be like me.
Yeah.
And then you turn up and you're like, how come you're so good? Oh, I used to play for Tottenham till I was 18. They've all got some connection.
Yeah.
It's like David Erwood. I think he was the only player that was older than me. And I thought, oh, good, he might not be any good either. And he was brilliant goalkeeper.
Yeah,
and I said,
how
come he's so good? Oh, well, I used to play for the England youth something, whatever.
Wow.
Yeah.
And there's not enough... I think it should be that you have to be a certain weight as a celebrity. Minimum weight.
Really?
It's a bit like heavyweight boxing.
Right.
Yeah, you've got to be at least... You know, you've got to do an exercise test to prove that you're really unfit.
Imagine that'd be good, the weigh-in the day before soccer. hanging with their bellies hanging out.
What's it like for the pros, Joe? Because obviously you've won league titles and you've got players that have played at the highest level. I mean, some of the celebs that play are amazing. Like, what is the mindset for the celebs going into it? The pros going into it, sorry.
So for my kids were too young. They remember the Tampa Bay Rowdies.
Yeah.
Which was, 7,000-8,000 people. So they knew their dad was a professional footballer. But they absolutely love it. So I go out there and I want to play well, because my kids are watching and they love it.
Right.
But they're not interested in how I play. They're more interested in...
Young blood.
Young blood and the singers and things like that. So, but from the pros' perspective, we have a great 3 days. You meet people like Lee and it is good fun, ain't it? Like the bar.
It is incredible. Like the
social.
It's the only time those in our world of entertainment that those people are going to come together. Even the non-footballers, the young blood.
Yeah.
Of course,
character he was.
He was brilliant. He was like the face of it this year because he was like, obviously, I hadn't heard of it.
I didn't realise they made humans like him.
He's incredible. He's incredible.
He's brilliant.
Really?
Like, he's like, I was chatting away to him and he's got his hair and he's a rock star. He's in America. Yeah. He's huge. Mm.
Massive profile, isn't he? Following.
Talks like Liam Gallagher.
Mm. Yeah. He's from Doncaster as well. Doncaster Road.
He's just like, he's mad. Like, I'm like, wow. Just like, he's such a ball of energy. And I wouldn't know who he was or would have no dealings with him throughout. But he's, yeah, what a lovely fella.
I don't know if you agree, Joe, but I feel like Lee is one of the biggest, or if not the biggest talking point of Soccer Aid because of everything that's happened. You've played 4 years now, right?
4 years, yeah. I mean, that's nice of you to say, but it is mainly to do with how low the bar was. You know what I mean? It's how little expectation there was. Right. It would be like if a seven-year-old came on and scored, of course he'd be the biggest talking point because then no one was expecting, including me.
Yeah.
In fact, when I think 88 and 89th minute or something, I had two chances to score and missed.
Yeah.
And if you add them up over the last 4 years, that's about, if you count the penalties as well, I've probably had seven or eight chances that you should score all of them.
Right. Yeah.
And I was having the imaginary conversation in my head.
Wow.
I looked at the clock, it said 89 or 90 minutes or whatever. And I said, in my head, I was going saying to my son, who'd come to watch, look, I have tried for 4 years. I've done everything I possibly, because he keeps going, do it one more time, you know.
Yeah.
And I was having the imaginary conversation going, look, I did everything I could. I went on the treadmill every day. I've done all I can do.
Yeah.
So can we just not do this anymore? Like, can we stop? And then Darren Fletcher passed me the ball as I was thinking it. And I went, oh! Kicked it in the net. It was like the rebirth of my international career.
Love it. So let's...
How did it feel? We need to go.
It gave me an insight into professional football. Had I not scored that, I would have been absolutely forgotten about in Soccer Aid. I've not done anything in 4 years. But one split-second goal, and suddenly, I'm apparently the face of this year's summer because of a second, 1 second thing that happened. Do you know what I mean?
That's a huge moment, isn't it? That's a great point because there's so many sliding doors moments in your career. So I remember it was one point at Chelsea when I was playing and things weren't going well. I got thrown on for 10 minutes and I was going to leave. This was early on in my career.
Going to leave Chelsea?
Going to leave Chelsea.
Wow.
And it was like a week before the transfer window. I was like, nah, whatever. Ball dropped to me. I think it was against Portsmouth. Banged it in. We won the game 2-0. Mm. When Portsmouth were good, it was quite a big game. And then 3 days later, we went to Anfield. Same again. Come off the bench. It's 0-0. Bang. Same thing. Scored the winner. Got on the coach and Jose said, "I've got to play you," and then it all changed. And you know, from there.
Similarly to me, I was going to retire. I was going to retire as a footballer. Thinking 53, I've not been picked up by one of the major clubs, and now look at me now.
Agents are on the phone.
About to meet Joe's agents to have some serious conversation.
I'll send him a text now.
Do you know what I love about that? That is the level we're talking about with that moment. Joe's comparing it to a moment at Chelsea with Jose Mourinho.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But he's right. It is roughly that. In my head. You've got to understand this. In reality, it's not. But in my head, in my head, I am capable of scoring that. Is it Sweden you scored the volley?
Yeah. What a goal.
I'm totally capable of doing that in my head. Yeah. And I am, in my head.
Yeah.
In fact, my goal in my head is better than what you scored. Because it's an overhead kick as well. You know what I mean? It puts yours to shame, the goal in my head.
Do you know that Lee's on the list with, I think, Maradona and Cantona as people that have scored one goal at Soccer Aid?
Yeah.
That's what we're talking about,
It's decent. That is decent. I haven't scored. I've done it for 3 years.
Have you never scored at Soccer
Aid? Not scored. I've done it for 3 years. I've played three halves.
Wow.
And I've lost every time. And I'm only coming back next year. Listen, if they ask me, I will come back. I will come back, please. But I want to win. Kids have watched me three times lose.
You see how much it means to the pros.
But
the ex-pros are generous. I mean, like there's very few. Darren Fletcher passed me the ball to score. And with like a minute to go and we're 2-0 up, almost everybody is going to have a shot, you know.
Mm.
But he just completely laid me on for what is considered a tap-in, but at my level is like scoring from the halfway line. And also I have to say, Robbie Keane was brilliant. He took me for a whole session the day before.
Yes.
And I've realised, I'm 53 and I've been playing five-a-side all my life and I've never realised that I've been kicking the ball with the wrong part of my foot till he told me.
Wow.
I've been like kicking it apparently too much towards the toe and he's just further back. Like,
really?
Put a little mark on my thing and he went, there, that's where you want to be kicking it.
Good advice.
And it was in my head as the ball came over, I thought, I'd missed two and I went, remember what Robbie said, middle of the foot.
That's brilliant because Robbie's like, to get that insight from Robbie, one of the top strikers of the last 20 years, but it's funny, I don't want to keep bringing it back to football. I remember, you talk about that, so in that moment you actually thought that, right?
In split seconds. Because I just messed up twice, and because he said to me, if you hit it with the wrong part of your foot, you'll feel it. And he was right. I felt sort of, not a pain, but if you kick it, I'm going to get my foot on the table. Instead of kicking it there, I'm kicking it there.
This is the coaching that we need.
Are you watching Capello? So I was kicking, by the way, butter on my toast. It was hurting my foot there.
Yeah.
Just a little bit. So when I missed twice, I thought, oh, I can feel it. He's right. Yeah. I messed up twice. And we watch it in slow motion. My foot collapses as I kick it.
Brilliant.
So as it came over, and it was the wrong foot, so it's even harder in my head. I'm left footed. So I was like, oh, how do I get.
Love this.
Well, going back to like our coaching, our important coaching is because Defoe, when he scored for England in 2010, he's the cross come in. I can't remember who crossed it, and he scored against who was it against? Do we remember? James Milner's good knowledge. James Milner crossed it.
I bet the editor has done this on prompt, and he'll just take credit. James Milner, that one, yeah.
But is this the World Cup you're talking about?
World Cup. He scored in the World Cup, and all he wanted to do.
Oh, was that that game?
Yeah, and all he wanted
1-0.
And he said he used to do a training session with Ian Wright, again another class striker. When we was coming through, Wright, he was coming towards the end, and Wright used to get him. Hold him by the back when a cross was coming in, a shooting drill, hold him by the back of his shirt and go, like, not now, not now, now you go. And then you meet the cross at the right time. And Defoe talks about, he said, in that moment, in the World Cup, 12 years later, he felt righty holding his shirt, not yet, not yet, not yet. And then bang, gone. And he scores at the World Cup.
Yeah.
And realize he's
so. You know the way defenders pull your shirt. Yeah. If you pulled his shirt and the ref would say, "Hey," and he goes, "Actually, can you do that?"
Yeah,
that's really helpful.
Can you
me.
Pull it? That really helps. Thank you.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you because you were Team England.
I was
three years, and then rest of the world. So where was that transformation transfer? How did that sort of come about?
Well, the official showbiz version of that story is that I did a documentary a few days before where Sven gives me a list of instructions to go and get ready for the match.
Yeah.
And at the end, he sacks me.
Right.
Obviously, that was my idea. Because I want to play for the rest of the world.
Yeah,
for
the
simple reason that because the England side, they do take it quite competitively.
Right.
And I didn't want to miss another penalty for them. I missed three on the run. And I thought, it isn't really fair on these guys. Because listen, I understand, if you could have made it as a pro but didn't quite, it's the same as... The only sport I've ever been any good at is darts. And when I did comet relief darts, me and Tim Vine, you know...
Yeah, there's a couple of Guinness World Records.
I did,
darts,
I had Guinness Book of Records for... Well, the bullseye one, main one. Yeah. Most balls in a minute. So it's always, I grew up in a pub, so it's my sport.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So when we did the darts for Comic Relief, they gave me and Tim Vine a little microphone.
Yeah.
And we had all the comics, and they said, "This is great because we'll have loads of banter and it'd be funny as well." We didn't utter a word. This was our moment. Like, it's great. Yeah, you almost got a 180, but where's the gags? I'm not interested in the gags. I want to prove. So it's the same for these guys that can play. You know, they don't want an idiot like me missing penalties.
Yeah.
So I thought I'll share out the badness and I'll be on the rest of the world for a while. But I have to say, the rest of the world were absolutely brilliant. They were I think I might be wrong, but you know better than me. But I think international footballers perhaps understand the basic concept of you're only as good as your weakest link. Maybe the England psychology.
Is that a fair comment, Joe?
I think that's a fair comment. I think it comes down to characters as well, like Lee saying in the dressing room. And I looked at the rest of the world had a better team. They did have better players.
Well, they did,
but they managed. But they managed it better than us. Maybe we was in the bar a little bit too much. But Lee's right. Okay. And Lee's, and I understand.
I mean, what's the dressing room like? You were there. I wasn't there this year, but I've been in the dressing room for a few years and it's quite like we've got to
go on. Take us into it, Joe, this year. What was it like?
Well, it's quite intense.
Yeah.
Like, do you know, because we're saying that Robbie Williams was there this year, wasn't it? So we got up and he was singing Angels. There's a funny.
In the dressing room.
He was singing Angels in the dressing room. Yeah. He's singing it and everyone's there clapping away, cameras up.
Yeah.
And I thought, I better film this. So I've got it on my phone filming it. And the funniest thing on the film is Scalzi, who's the most deadpan guy ever. Talk about taking it seriously. He's right next to Robbie and Robbie's up doing his thing. And everyone's like, oh, this is brilliant. And Scalzi's like looking at him like, you could his mannerism, you could see him going, "Will you just shut up in your head?" And I'm like,
but it is, there is definitely, I mean, listen, the celebs are like that as well. And like I say, understandably so, if you're good at football, you want to win and all that. But I, you know, as I pointed out to someone in the morning, that, you know, it's all good taking it seriously, but you've got to remember that in the second half at the beginning, a man came on dressed as a 6 foot whistle.
That's true.
You know what I mean? Stephen Mulhern was a 6 foot whistle.
I
think once that, it's all bets off after that, isn't it?
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Lee, right. So Sven's naming the team, and we're like, well, we've only named 10 players, and we've got like the mystery, the masked winger.
The masked winger,
So, you didn't know who it was to reveal the outfit.
So I'm thinking, my head's going, Bundles, I'm thinking, this has got to be a big area. This has got to be Tom Cruise. This has got to be like,
I know.
You know, I don't know, Will Ferrell, Tom Cruise, Will someone's coming Ferrell. Back. I'm thinking, this is going to be brilliant.
Yeah.
You know?
and it's the geezer from Catchphrase. He pops up with like sponge feet. And I'm like, what's, do you know what?
I mean, Stephen will be the first to say that, you know, that I think we were all. I was slightly expecting Pelé, if I'm going to be honest.
Really?
Oh, I knew Beckham was going to be there. I thought, I wonder if they put Beckham in the costume.
Yeah.
Because you're on the pitch with Clarence Seedorf and Usain Bolt.
Yeah.
Anything goes. Like anything could be anyone.
So okay, when when you found out it was Stephen Malherne. Your initial reaction.
Well, can I get his autograph? Will I be able to get close enough to him for him to sign my shirt and stuff like that? And at one point, Usain Bolt was in my way, and I just threw him to the ground. No, it was great because he's connected with I like the idea that it's a bit more light entertainment. You don't get any more light entertainment than Stephen.
Exactly.
He does all the big shows, so. I like that, you know, but I think the ones that take it seriously do want him on the pitch for too long. But fair enough, even I draw the line at a man in a fancy dress costume for 10 minutes. You know what I mean?
You agree with that, Joe,
I presume. Sure.
Yeah.
Like, I was like...
I bet Wayne Rooney wasn't happy with that.
No, Wayne was like... At half-time, Wayne was kicking off. You have to remember, like, it's all nice.
Yeah.
Then the competitive... I can't even remember what Wazza was ranting about half-time. It was something I'm saying. I was like... So you always got to find the balance between your instinct in us as footballers want to explode, but you control it and you realise you're making a TV show and everyone's got to have fun and all that. But then Wayne just come out with I can't even remember what it was. It was something about tracking back or sorting it out. And then we went on and a geezer in a whistle suit come out and played and thought, what chance have
we got? The decision I made to go to the other side was made last year. You might not remember this, but when we played last year, Bradley Walsh, who was the coach, I mean, if that doesn't say all about how lads entertainment this show is or should be.
Yeah.
As I was walking on, I was getting on the pitch, he put his arm around me and he went, you've just got one job on this pitch, right? You've got to track backwards and forwards with Patrice Evra and Mark. And I looked at him and went, I can't do that, Bradley. Well, you've got to do it, right? So I did. I did what I was told. Yeah. I was so exhausted. He nutmegged me, his fancy nutmeg.
Yeah.
Just absolutely destroyed me, obviously.
Yeah.
And then I had a bit of a sulk. And in the I think it's called the interval or half time.
The interval.
I said to Bradley, I had a little strop and I went, no, I'm not doing this anymore. Get Joe Cole to do it.
And did Joe Cole do it?
I think he did. I said, I'm just going to go. Goal hang is the only position I can do because you actually don't have to run back as fast as the others because the camera's off you and you just have a little stroll back, little chat to the defender, you know, get back to the halfway line and you're not, you can walk back, you know.
Yeah.
I can't be tracking up a damn with Patrice Evra.
Speaking of players, like you've mentioned great pros that play, who have you been most impressed with, best players celebrity-wise? Who are the standout players?
Celebrity, well, in terms of quality of play, I suppose Mark Wright's probably one of the better. He actually, I think he played for Crawley for a while or something.
He did play in the FA Cup, didn't he?
Mark can play. Mark was a... Mark's
Spurs,
a good footballer. He played for Spurs till he was 18. So you can tell Mark's can play. And then obviously the Crawley thing happened. And then Tom Grennan, I was impressed.
Yeah, Tom Grennan was very, very good.
Tom
Grennan. I thought David Irwin, he didn't play this year, but David Irwin was great in Nets when he played.
Who else?
But I don't judge them by their skills on the pitch. I judge them by how light entertainment they are.
Right.
Yeah. So for me, you'll never beat Stephen Mulhern. Because he came on as a 6-foot whistle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You'll never
beat. He stole the show.
You know what I mean? He's getting a lot of airtime, Stephen Mulhern, isn't he?
No, who else are like? Kennedy's a really good player.
Dermot Kennedy. Chelsea Grimes. I mean, I can't work out if you'd class her as the footballer or the celeb because she writes music.
She's amazing,
she
isn't
plays
she?
For Liverpool. She plays for some team.
Footballer, artist.
Yeah.
Right. Does everything, yeah.
She laid me on for a couple.
Yeah.
In a skirt, one of these.
Yeah, if Chelsea's, I did a FIFA tournament with for BT with Chelsea and I beat her. So she's listening because she gave me a bit of stick about losing the game. So if you listen, I'm still the FIFA champion.
Still the FIFA champion. What do you get more nervous?
But
about
I have to say, just in answer to that question, obviously Joe's one. Joe was. I like the ones that immediately put you at your ease and think you're not. It doesn't matter if you mess up.
Yeah.
And Joe did that brilliantly when I played.
I gather that you two got on very well behind the scenes.
Yeah, because he made me feel like, look, it just, you know, he's. It puts you at your ease, which is, you know. And obviously, this year, Robbie Keane was brilliant with me.
Yeah.
And I have to give a shout out to Darren Fletcher. He was such a nice guy. And he laid me on. He kept saying, you know, you'll be all right. Just, you know, I'll tell you where to go and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, it's great.
If I go back next year and play, I'll make sure that I'm more like that. Because you're right. I think it gets a little bit intense in the England dressing room. And I think you play better football when you're relaxed. Nobody, I'm just thinking of my career, nobody wants to be. There's enough pressure being a professional
cracking the whip
for England.
Yeah.
You get more with sugar than you do with salt sometimes. With coaching players, and you need that.
But I tell you now, there's definitely, you know, everyone does. There's an alpha thing that goes on with guys when they're together. I noticed it when Freddie Flintoff played with us. Freddie's such a gentle, he's a big guy, but he's actually quite a gentle, nice guy. Yeah. Mm. And he was on the coach, and we were travelling up to Manchester. And you know, on the coach, where you have like, you go downstairs to the toilet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, he was stood at the top of that chatting with the lads at the back, blah, blah, blah. The coach turns and he falls down the stairs, and you hear him bang, his head got bang. Now, he's in the world of telly now. Yeah. That would be in telly land. That would be, are you all right, Freddie? Shall I get you a cappuccino? You know what I mean? That didn't happen. Everyone just shouted out, ah, you you know, that's how it's, that's what happens. It brings out that everyone starts shouting and it gets, and the second year I did it, I think, was the first time that women played in Soccer 8. Mm. And it just was so much better for someone like me who can't play. There was a sort of more gentle, feminine thing spread through the two.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I have to give a shout-out to Katie Chapman and Kelly Smith, who were just...
They're brilliant, aren't
they? Kelly this year was like, you know... I said to her afterwards, there's a picture of her, like, congratulating me after I scored, where she's got a hand on my face. And I sent her a message saying, this looks like you're the mum and I'm the child who's just used the potty for the first time.
She's great, Kelly Smith.
She's so nice. Yeah. And Katie was the same. They were so like, you'll be all right, don't worry, everything will be all right, you know. Because it's quite nerve-wracking, you know, if you think in your head you can do what you did against Sweden, but the reality is you can't.
It's nice hearing stories. Like, we've had Kelly on, and she was talking so positive about Soccer Aid. You mentioned Darren Fletcher there as well. I remember speaking to Chunks last year, and he said that Darren Fletcher actually gave him his medal when he missed the penalty. That was how much of a
That's class.
And he said for him, that sort of made that penalty miss feel a little bit better than it was.
I have to say, one of my favourite photos of me scoring is Chunks, who's playing for England.
Yeah.
Running up to celebrate with us. Because he missed a penalty and I missed a penalty.
Yeah.
And he knows what it's like. So he's like that.
Yeah.
And I said, oh, that's great. He went, I don't think Wayne was happy with me.
No, but like, I said to Chunks, after he missed the penalty last year, he was really disappointed.
He was gutted, didn't he? Yeah.
I was
he was so upset.
I was like, listen, mate. I said, listen, go. I said, don't worry about it. It doesn't matter. I said, come back stronger next year. You've got all year to train. Blah, 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 blah. And he did. And he lost so much weight.
He looks so good now, didn't he? Yeah.
And he's, you know, he says he's going to come back stronger. So, like, even he's gone a little bit personal journey. He's going to, because he's still a young man, Chance. Mm. He's going to come back stronger next year. He could be doing this for 10 years.
Yeah, he's top lad, isn't he?
And he can play, by the way, as well.
Yeah, he can, yeah.
Yeah, he can play.
The reason I mention that is because you spoke about penalties. I think you missed three in 3 years. So, how difficult
still
was
talking about that, aren't we? Do you remember before we said sliding doors, you score one goal and everything changes?
It's building up to that moment. This is where it's going to make that moment even more special when you talk about that. But what were those moments like, missing those?
The first year I did it, I took the fifth penalty to win it.
Mm. Yeah.
So to me, it's like a script to me, Edward. Listen, as a stand-up comedian, you learn to have very thick skin.
Yeah.
So everyone goes, well, you're nervous. I go, not only was I not nervous, I was sort of writing the script in my head about being held aloft, scoring the win. It was a no-brainer.
It's dangerous.
I thought, well, this is just perfect, right? I'm scoring the fifth penalty to win the game. Mm. So I stepped up. I mean, you know, they say a bit nervous running up. I got the ball quickly in case they changed their mind. Yeah. I'm taking it. And I think in my head I was going, right, how am I going to celebrate?
Yeah, you know,
Kicked, missed by, I would say, that much, and not by a male, as Robbie Savage said in the commentary. He's missed by a male. That might have been Ruth Maddox and Heidi High. But I missed I was that far away fractions. From glory.
Yeah.
And Blake Harrison stepped up, took the sixth one from the in-betweeners.
Yeah.
He scores. He's a lovely bloke, so I was quite pleased for him.
Yeah.
I wasn't pleased at the time. I was devastated.
Yeah.
Absolutely devastated. That it's not that, look, I like to pretend that, oh no, I missed for a chance for my team to... Forget all that.
Yeah.
All I cared about that moment was, as a 50-year-old man who didn't even make the school team, to a sold out Old Trafford.
Yeah.
This is never going to crop up again.
Wow.
Yeah. And I missed my opportunity.
Yeah.
So the following year, it's all in the script that I'm going to score then, isn't it? And I missed again.
Yeah.
And the third year, by this point, I've stopped writing the script. I've now decided by the third year not to concentrate too much on the celebration after I've scored. Maybe think about how I'm going to try and score this.
Prioritise scoring.
I've tried everything. I've gone in my garden, set up goal, the size of a goal with some masking tape against the wall.
Yeah.
And practice endlessly and said to my son, how should I do it? Top left or bottom right? Yeah. How should I do it? You tell me. And we'd practice. Missed again, you know what I mean? So I'd given up. I've realised that, you know, you something happens when you're over 50 or even over 40, in your brain and your feet stop connecting in any way. You know, there's a reason, if you think about snooker, You know, you think that there's no fitness involved. So the older you get, you should be getting better and better and better. Yeah. But there's no world champions past sort of 40, 45. Mm. Because something happens between the brain and your limbs that it just stop. So now I just can't kick the ball anymore. I could never kick it well, but now I can't kick it at all. So there's a disconnect, I think.
Did you get any help from pros to practice the pens? Like you said, Robbie Keane was helping Robbie Keane with technique. Was it always Robbie Keane or were there other people that were
helping? Well, I never bothered. I'd never practiced at all. I mean, literally at all. Mm. I think, and so that this year I said, right, I'll do a bit, you know, a bit in the garden. But on the actual training for the 3 days, I said to Robbie, can we just go out and spend an hour practicing penalties in case it crops up? And it cropped up 3 years on the run, so I was expecting it. And thank God he did, because he taught me how to kick it, which then came in handy when I scored, not on a penalty. Yeah. Though, so.
Yeah. You probably didn't have time to think about it. Do you know, with a penalties, it's such a unique process, even for a footballer, and especially say it, you know, because you've got the time to think about it. Like I said, Lee's mind goes to the script and the celebration. Some footballers, I wasn't a penalty taker, but like, I took a few, scored some, missed some, but bloody hell, like, it just shows you the processes that go in your mind when you're playing football, all the little intricacies.
I've got to admit, the first year I did it, in fact, even probably the second year I took a penalty, I remember thinking in my head, you know, people say, oh, it's nerve wracking and the goal shrinks and all that. Actually, I remember sitting there, standing there, looking at the goal, thinking, it's unforgivable that these professionals miss.
Really?
I mean, it's massive.
Really?
It's massive. I'm not that far out. Not only am I going to score, how does anyone ever miss these? And even when I missed the four, but I was just unlucky. They still should be scoring these.
Do you think, like you said about being a stand-up comedian and having thick skin, do you think that helps you, that... Not that footballers should do stand-up, but...
Yeah.
Because most people do shrink. Like, that's interesting that you've gone...
But it's delusion. I think it's delusion. What happens when you're a stand-up, you learn very early on, one of the first rules are, for God's sake, pretend to them that you think it's funny. If they're not laughing, they want to know what you think is funny. That's all stand-up is. Yeah. Come on, show me what you think's funny then.
Yeah.
And if they believe you think it's funny, you can win them round. Hmm. So you put on this false facade, even if you're dying on your backside early on in your career, where you're just going, you might not be enjoying this, I'm having the time of my life. And it's like, you come up stage going, it's awful. But you pretend on stage that you're loving it.
Yeah.
And you do that so many times, I think you actually start believing it. You start believing you're having a wonderful time to the point where it comes true. See what I mean? So when you get onto the football pitch, you go, I'm so deluded, I'm so thick-skinned, but I just go, well, of course I'm going to score. How can I possibly miss?
Just get the collars up like camp.
It's not a question of will I score, it's how will I score.
Mate.
Top left, bottom right, you know.
Lee, on that, you were talking about nerves and the thick skin and false facade. Where do you get more nerves then? Stepping up for that penalty, playing football, or packed Apollo, Hammersmith Apollo with loads of people doing what you do? Because I imagine, I mean, both of those are quite nerve-wracking situations.
Well, it depends what you mean. The first year I took it, definitely the Apollo, because the first year I took the penalty, I thought I was going to score. And what if I don't anyway? It doesn't really matter, does it? I'm a comedian. There's no expectation.
Yeah. Okay.
But as the years went on, it's more about my son. My son was mocking me relentlessly.
Really?
And he was in the crowd. And, that, you know, I
behind the goal, just mocking me.
Putting me off. But I made sure that when he's come along, I've looked out for him. I thought, when I score, I want to go to my son.
Yeah.
You know, that's how deluded I am. But this year it came in handy because I scored and I found him. Like, and you can see me on camera looking at him. And, you know, was the... And again, it goes back to that thing of, I've never played at any level, not even in the school team.
Yeah.
So to go from five-a-side with the dads to Clarence Seedorf and Patrice Evra.
Yeah.
I mean, on the coach from the hotel to the thing, I sat with Clarence Seedorf, Patrice Evra, and Nigel de Jong.
Wow.
And me.
Wow.
And I thought, I bet you Clarence doesn't know who I am. So he might think I'm an ex-pro. Do you know what I mean?
How quickly did you realise?
But
where would you have gone? What player would you have gone for?
Oh, I wouldn't have said I'm a player. I'd have said I'm Lee Mack, but I would have pretended I was an ex-pro.
Right.
He hasn't. You can't have heard of all the professionals, can you? You'll forget some of them. I'd have probably gone.
What would your backstory been?
Blackburn? I'd have said I started off at Doncaster Rovers.
Yeah.
And then, of course. Then Blackburn found me. So that's when we won the Premier League in 95. Played alongside Colin Endre and Graeme Le Saux and Jason Wilcox and all them lot.
Yeah.
And then I decided to pack it in and join Arsenal. I've never even come close to wanting to support a London club, obviously. But if I did, it'd have to be Spurs.
Really?
I'd like to hear that.
Yeah, because...
Nice.
Why?
I think Ralph Coates in the 70s. Remember Ralph Coates? He had a hairstyle that was a proper comb-over.
Right.
And he used to run up the ring really fast. and it would lift like that. Almost like... like a sail on a boat. It's like it was helping him run. Like it so push him up the wing, and then it would just fall down.
Is that the reason you have you quite like Tottenham then?
Yeah, my brother was in a band called The Return of Ralph Coates.
No
because
way.
Because he loved Ralph Coates so much.
Shut up.
Honestly.
It seems like, would I lie to you now? Well,
yeah, I should point out.
It's so true then.
Yeah, when I say a band, I wouldn't go to the local vinyl shop and look for any albums. They did about three games.
Massive Ralph Coates fan.
iTunes.
I loved Ralph. But 70s footballers all looked ridiculous, didn't they?
I know.
And Ralph Coates was one of the kings of ridiculous looking. And they were such a... I just loved that old 70s Tottenham team, you know, and early 80s Tottenham. So I wouldn't support... My son came home after a big... You know, everyone at his school supports Chelsea or Arsenal, everybody. So he came home when he was about eight and he said, I don't need to support Chelsea or Arsenal. I was like, does it have to be one of them two? He obviously didn't. He wasn't having Blackburn.
Really?
No, and then he came on with this, I've decided I'm going to support Manchester United.
Really?
And I was actually happy, even though I'm a Blackburn fan. I thought that's a northern, good old northern traditional club.
Wow.
And then the day after he said it, Ferguson resigned, or said he was going to resign, and the club went absolutely down it.
Wow.
And I remember him almost in tears once going, I thought you said they win everything.
Blackburn, we're going to talk briefly about them now. Championship, would you be ecstatic, buzzing? Would that make your season if they were to get back into the Premier League? Because they're doing all right at the minute.
Well, yeah, they're doing all right. They've lost the last couple.
They're still in and amongst it, though.
They always are. The last couple of years, what they tend to do is they start off the first few weeks, they're always around the playoffs.
Yeah. Mm.
Then they get out of the playoffs, and then you're sort of more resigned, and you go, it doesn't matter now because they'll probably not make it. And then they annoyingly start going back up again towards them. And then you're looking at it, and you start doing that thing you should never do as a football fan. Yeah. If Huddersfield lose today and Blackburn win, all that, and then by the end of the season, they're always mid-division. Well, let's say always. They went down, of course, a couple of years ago to League One. But I love that season. They're winning all the time. Really? It's fantastic. Yeah. But they are classic. If they went up now, you know, it's not. They're not a realistically a Premier League club.
Are the Venky's still there?
Yeah, they still own it. And Mowbray's great.
Tony Mowbray's a really good guy. Really good. I've worked with him before. Yeah. He's a proper man. Yeah, I think Blackburn will get there again.
I don't think it'll be this season.
It was every time I played at Ewood Park, freezing.
Every single time,
mate.
When it was?
Because it's in the sort of.
It might also be to do with that your school uniform was shorts and a t-shirt. Do you know what I mean? You were turning up all the time, running around a football pitch with hardly anything on. That might be. But Blackburn is always cold and wet, like Manchester.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, there's more rain in Manchester than anywhere in Britain.
I think because, like, you know, you got the sort of cornered off. You know, it was only Stoke City was one where the wind could get in, and Blackburn was one.
Yeah.
Also, Blackburn was one of the few that you could still sit on a hill and watch the game rather than playing together, you know.
Yeah.
And at Stoke, funny enough, you can do the same. Well, there's areas that fans sit.
It may be something to do with that. We'd have to get a weather specialist on to find out why.
Interestingly, 50-1 with Coral to win the championship this season. Blackburn 8th at the minute.
I can't look past West Brom and Fulham and Bournemouth.
Bournemouth
come
well
from
well,
one of them, one of them three teams. There's two. The gap between the Championship and the Premier League now is, I think he goes through cycles, doesn't it? I think at the moment he's getting bigger and bigger because the teams that come down are just I've watched three or four games, I think they're streets ahead of everyone else.
There seems to be another gap now. There's the Premier League and the Championship, but then there's the top Championship clubs and the rest of the Championship as well. So you've got those teams like Fulham and West Brom and sort of clubs that can go up and down a lot, and the Norwiches and all these clubs that they seem to tend a bit of time in the Premier League, a bit of time in the Championship.
Yeah.
And Fulham probably are the most yo-yo-y in terms of, you know. But Blackburn aren't at that. You know, I'd be happy if Blackburn were at the level of the top of the Championship.
I wonder now. Now, them teams, you know, your Norwiches, your Fulhams, West Broms, who go up and down. Yeah. Like, financially, where that puts them, because you don't really lose out that much because you get the parachute payments if you come back within two seasons. Plus, you end up selling your players on because they've got Premier League experience. I'd be interested in that. I wouldn't say they're doing it on purpose because it. Do you know? I'm like,
no, but you'd certainly hint at it.
I would hint at it and just let the public take it. I'm like, because if you're going to go up to the Premier League at some point, like Norwich, for instance, you'd think to yourself, right, we've been up and down, up and down, up and down. We've got to spend money. These players we got are not going
to sustain themselves
in
the Premier League. Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? But at one point, when does the process become, well, we need to do something different because we're just going up and down. I don't know.
We're going to look ahead at a fixture, which is the World Cup qualifier for England against Andorra, Joe.
We're playing against them, and this defender, it's the only time I've ever experienced this in professional football.
Yeah.
Like, just booting me in the ankles while the play's over there. I'm thinking, where's, like, VAR? Like, I'm like, what's going on here? I turn around and I said, why are you fucking doing this, mate?
And he's gone, well, I can't stop you, so I've got to kick you.
Is that what you said?
Very honest.
In perfect English, I went, fair point. It's like proper pub football.
Really?
What's like, kicking you?
I love all that. You know, these teams, these international teams, that the population is so small.
Yeah.
I mean, Iceland's another one. They do so well. And I think the population's like, is it 250,000 or
it's
something?
Ridiculous how if you, well
And also, yeah. Don't forget, it's 250,000, but it's to play in the men's internationals, you've got to be a man. So that's only 50% of the population.
Yeah.
And you've got to be probably over 17 and under 40.
Yeah.
And if you start working out, you go, if I lived in Iceland, it would only be a matter of time before I'd have got a game.
Yeah.
Everyone gets a game at some point. You know what I mean? It's hardly anyone to pick from. And Andorra, what's the population of Andorra?
Andorra's
the
off the top of my head, I can't tell you what the population of Andorra is.
It's pretty small, isn't it?
It's tiny.
If you think Andorra can nick a home victory, Coral will give you odds of 100-1. It's 20-1 if you reckon England will win the match 4-1. Big match for England. Brilliant getting Lee on the show. I just want to end by just going on about that goal again. I think it's only applicable. Yeah. We talk about that moment. Because in the scripts, I want to read the exact question Jack wrote, which said about how that moment, after all the heartache you'd been through with England, how did it feel to redeem yourself and score in front of a stadium? Well, I just love the way Jack wrote that, as if you had played in a World Cup final for England.
In my head, I have. Yeah. That's the thing. That was my World Cup final.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you exactly how it felt. I had obviously, you know, I'm 53. I was running backwards and forwards to the halfway line because of the offside. I was exhausted.
Yeah.
I scored, and then it takes over, and you're going, oh, and you can't believe it. And then everyone was really nice, and they all cuddled around me and huddled around me, and I was in this group, oh, I can't believe it.
Yeah.
And as something obviously happened emotionally, where I started to retch. I went,
wow.
And luckily it went back down again. Because if I had puked, how different the story would have been. Because they'd have all pulled away from the group, and I'd have been covered in sick, and like Patrice Evra would have been going, what are you doing? That's ruined the photographs, the moment. I went,
why do you think that happened?
Like, I was overwhelmed. It happened to, I think it was a guy called, in 1978 Cup Final, the winning goal by an Ipswich player. I think his name was Osgood, I might be wrong, or Osborne. He scores a goal, Roger Osborne. He scores the winner in 1978, and he can't believe it. And within minutes, he's taken off because he's exhausted because of he was overwhelmed.
Yeah?
Yeah. Wow. I might have imagined that. You know, you can bet on whether a player gets so exhausted he has to come off because he's so excited and then he's vomited on himself.
Joe, just finally from you, brilliant having Lee on the show, reliving that, and your just finest memories of playing with Lee at Soccer Aid, and just nice to hear what it means for the celebs as well, isn't it?
Playing with Lee, I was so pleased for him. I was on the pitch? I think I was on the pitch. I was one of them grumpy ex-players at the time because I'd lost for the third year in a row.
Yeah.
And I didn't get a chance to congratulate him afterwards because I had to shoot down because I was doing something on Sunday morning. So well done.
Oh, thanks, Joe.
Oh, there we go.
And
thanks.
Can we re-sign you for England for next year?
Ooh.
Is it a possibility, or have you
all I can say is you'll have to go. Your agent will have to talk to my agent about that,
which is the same guy at the moment.
If I can sign with your agent, we can make it happen. But I don't know. You don't really get transfer fees for international football, do you? You can't really.
Not really.
It's a shame, otherwise, because I'm only in it for the money.
Big thanks to Lee for coming on the show, everyone. You have been watching All to Play For, brought to you by Joe and Cole, myself, Adam Smith, Joe Cole. Don't forget to find us on Joe's YouTube channel and wherever you get your podcast. Brilliant.
You've been watching All to Play For, brought to you by Joe and Coral.